blessings. Every time I turn around, blessings on blessings. Every time I turn around, blessings, blessings.
Verses 30 through 37, and it reads as follows. Leaving that religion, they traveled through Galilee. Jesus didn't want anyone to know he was there, for he wanted to spend more time with his disciples and teach them. He said to them, "The Son of Man is going to be betrayed into the hands of the enemies. He will be killed, but 3 days later, he will rise from the dead." They didn't understand what he was saying. However, and they were afraid to ask him what he meant. After they traveled to Capernaum and settled in a house, Jesus asked his disciples, "What were you discussing on the road?" But they didn't answer because they had been arguing about which of them was the greatest. He sat down, called the 12 disciples over to him, and said, "Whoever wants to be first must take last place and be the servant of everyone else." Then he put a little child among them. Taking the child in his arms, he said to them, "Anyone who welcomes a little child like this on my behalf welcomes me. And anyone who welcomes me welcomes not only me, but also my Father who sent me." May the Lord add a blessing to the reading to his already blessed word. Let us pray. All wise Father, we thank you for this opportunity to come to you in prayer, Lord God. We thank you for this moment and we thank you for this time. We pray right now, Lord God, that your name be blessed in any way possible. And right now that your praises are given all across the world, anyone who can hear my voice all across this internet. We pray, Lord God, that the people that are seeking to find right now solace in this world that they are seeking you, Lord God, and you're providing a comforter, the Holy Spirit, for them, Lord God. We thank you right now, Lord God, for providing. We thank you right now, Lord God, for your worship, the ability to worship, the ability to praise you, Lord God, and we thank you for those opportunities. We pray right now for our world, Lord God. We see what is happening. We thank you that we know your hand of protection is on us, Lord God. And we ask right now that you continue to protect us. You know what is coming in the future, Lord God. And we just await and we thank you for the presence that you've given us. In your name, Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Grace, the grace. amen, amen, amen. In times like this, it is good that you can say, I'm still alive. Amen. That is a testimony right there in and of itself. Amen. We got people just that's going away every single day. But God saw fit. God saw fit that you're still here with us.
Amen.
Amen. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. We want to thank our praise team this morning for leading us in worship and praise. Our pianists for leading us, leading a few songs and playing. And also we want to thank our video and audio directors in the back. Amen. Making sure everything is good and sounds great. But there is a word. There is a word. And we thank God for you for allowing you, for taking your time out to tuning in and watching us on Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, whatever time you see fit that you get on this broadcast. We thank you for taking time out of your day. But there is a word from God on today. Let us turn to Mark, the 9th chapter, verses 30 through 37. Mark, the 9th chapter, verses 30 through 37. It says, leaving that region, they traveled through Galilee. Jesus didn't want anyone to know he was there, for he wanted to spend more time with his disciples and teach them. He said to them, The Son of Man is going to be betrayed into the hands of his enemies. He will be killed, but 3 days later, he will rise from the dead. They didn't understand what he was saying. However, they were afraid to ask him what he meant. After they arrived in Capernaum and settled in a house, Jesus asked his disciples, "What were you discussing on the road?" But they didn't answer because they had been arguing about which one of them was the greatest. He sat down, called the 12 disciples over to him and said, "Whoever wants to be first must take last place and be the servant to everyone else." Then he put a little child among them, taking the child in his arms and said to them, "Anyone who wants to welcome a little child like this on my behalf welcomes me. Anyone who welcomes me welcomes not only me, but also the Father who sent me." We're going to take for a title or a subject this morning, you have to know the path in order to be great. You have to know the path in order to be great. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you again for this moment in time that you have set aside for preaching. We ask you, God, to hide me behind the cross so that people see none of me and all of thee. In the name of Jesus, we do pray. Amen, amen, and amen. As we're taking this year, we will do great things because we serve greater. We want to look at this. You can't do great things if you don't know the path to greatness. The second half of the Gospel of Mark, beginning in chapter 8, details Jesus' journey to Jerusalem, where he knows he will be delivered into the hands of lawless men and be crucified. The shadow of the cross is looming large in our Lord's mind now, and that's why in verse 30, he pulls his disciples aside for the third time to tell them that he will soon be rejected and killed. But on the third day, he would rise again. But again, the disciples didn't understand what he meant. We may wonder why the disciples had such a hard time understanding what seemed so clear to us. But we need to remember that the disciples have deeply embedded image of what the Messiah will do, will look like, and an image based on many Old Testament passages that speak to the Messiah ruling from David's throne in Jerusalem over the kingdom that has no end, with a military might that shatters all Israel oppressors. So, as Jesus and his disciples were approaching Jerusalem, it's almost if they are heading into two different directions. Jesus, knowing he is descending into the valley of the cross, his disciples thinking that they are ascending to a glorious moment, Jesus takes up his rightful throne and they will be right beside him. And in part, they didn't understand because they didn't want to understand. So with the glorious image of the kingdom, that God being established when they came into Jerusalem, it's not surprising that they begin to speculate and then argue about which of them is the greatest in the kingdom. They needed to know the chain of command. And Jesus has to have a number two man, so why couldn't it be me? Each of the 12 disciples argue that he is uniquely qualified to be the man. And so in the remainder of the journey to Capernaum is spent self-promoting and jockeying for position. But there are two paths to being great. There are two ways that God can get you to be great. When they finally arrived to their destination in Capernaum, Jesus, who wasn't a part of the discussion, asked, "Hey, what were you guys arguing about on the road?" And suddenly no one had anything to say. You know how it is when you walk into a room and people have been talking and discussing, and then automatically as soon as you walk in, it gets quiet. You know how it is when somebody that broke something in the house, if you got more than one child, you know, sometimes things mysteriously get broken and no one wants to take the blame for the things getting broken. So when you ask the question, who broke it, no one is silent, is quiet, but you heard the commotion as you was walking up your pathway to get into the house, and all of a sudden the house falls silent. That's how these disciples were. As soon as Jesus asked the question, nobody had anything to say. Whereas they had been yelling at each other on the road, no one wants to say a word. They are embarrassed to admit they have been arguing over which of them was the greatest. But even though they never do tell Jesus what the argument was about, Jesus knows exactly what it was about. And so Mark says this, Jesus sits down, which is what rabbis did in those days when they're about to teach you an important lesson. He called his disciples to himself and began to teach them about greatness. It's the teaching that we all need to hear, because there is a way in which we all want to be great. We may not have any great ambition to be the president of these United States. And with the way this country is looking now, I don't know who wants to be the president, wants to grow up to be the president right now. Will we have an insurrection at our capital? Will we be threatened at every capital in the 50 states of the United States? There are supposed to be some type of armed protest where now they're trying to say the black people that stole the election, black folk that stole the country, black and Latino people have upset the racist white folk that we have about this country. But everybody wants to be great. Everybody wants to be somebody until it's time to be somebody. And they was all big and boastful and proud when they went into the Capitol. Now, where the tightest security is, where all the HD and 4K cameras is, they mad and upset that we done found who they are, what their face look like, found out that there's some fire department folk that they had the insurrection. They then found out that there was some retired police or some off-duty police people that was in this insurrection. And when black folk been telling you since the 60s, the 50s, and the 40s, that there have been corrupt police, corrupt officials, corrupt stuff all this long time, but you didn't want to believe what we had to say, because the images they put out on black people is that we ain't nothing but lazy criminals and we just trying to take. But we found out now, it is not just us. It's everybody that got some issues, that have some deep-rooted, deep-seated stuff. But I was watching, I was looking at a comedian one day, and they say every movie that has a black president, something crazy fitting to happen. But all we needed was a racist president for the whole system to fall down. Amen. But you might not have the ambition to be the president or discover the cure for cancer or sit beside T.D. Jakes. But there is a desire in each and every one of us to be great. Deep down inside, you want to be great. I want to be great. We may not want to admit it, but we may be silent about it like the disciples were silent, but it is in you. And we have in all times promoted ourselves ahead of others in order to jockey for position. But notice that Jesus doesn't rebuke them for their desires to be great. Instead, he tells them how to accomplish their desires. If anyone would be first, he must be last and be a servant of all. It's not wrong to want to be great. In fact, I have to submit to you that as an inner desire that we have to be great, it doesn't flow from pride, rather it comes from God. And I know it sounds weird, and you might think I've been reading too many self-esteem or self-help books, but I don't think the desire to be great comes from that pride. God created us in his image, and a part of being in God's image bears greatness. Yeah. God is hardwired and desired to be great deep within each and every one of us. Pride doesn't create the desire to be great. Pride just corrupts our God-given desire to be great. Amen. And it does it by pointing us in the exact opposite direction of greatness. Jesus doesn't rebuke his disciples for this desire. He redirects their desires down a completely different path. Pursuing greatness is not our problem. Pursuing greatness down the wrong path is our problem. Romans 2, 6, and 8 describes two types of people traveling down two very different paths in their search for greatness with two very different results. It says he will judge everyone according to what they have done. He will give eternal life to those who keep doing good, seeking after the glory and the honor and the immortality that God offers. But he will pour out his anger and wrath on those who live for themselves and who refuses to obey the truth, instead living a life of lies and wickedness. See, I think it boils down to this. It's a simple fork in the road. Christ's path to be great and pride's path to be great. And everyone takes one or the other. And let's look at this first path. The pride's path for greatness. Look again for me for a moment at what the greatness has become to the disciples. They were arguing about who's the greatest, but their pride had reduced greatness to nothing more than a pecking order. Who will be number one? Who will be in the front of the line? And this isn't just in one-time conflict. This fight for position is an ongoing source of tension among the 12. Even if you turn to Mark, the 10th chapter, one chapter over, 32 through 45, James and John were very ambitious, and they decided to take matters into their own hands. They probably thought Peter was making a move for that number one spot. And after all, even though it was the three of them, Peter, James, and John, were chosen by Jesus to go up to the mount where Jesus was transfigured, it always seemed to be Peter that's mentioned first. What's up with that? Why isn't it James and John and Peter? Doesn't Jesus see that Peter has issues? He's constantly putting his foot in his mouth. So this is a really big deal as James and John go to Jesus confidently and ask him to put them at the number 2 and 3 positions. See, this isn't about seating arrangement. This isn't about sitting in the two or three seats of power of authority in the kingdom. They're asking Jesus to name them as the greatest disciples. And when the other 10 heard about their request, they got angry and was offended. They can't believe it. How could James and John be so arrogant? How could they be so seamlessly selfish and ambitious? And why didn't I think of it first? See, the pride of position is an ongoing problem for the disciples. And that's what pride does. It turns the pursuit of greatness into a pursuit of personal promotion. Greatness is reduced to nothing more than a me first when it comes to pride. Pride's path to greatness doesn't need great accomplishments. And we know we see that personally. Or lofty ambitions to qualify us for a twisted path. Our life's ambition could be nothing more than a lying on the couch watching TV with a bag of Utz potato chips, and yet still have this banging on our hearts as me first. Pride's path to greatness welcomes both the supercharged, the self-confident person, and the timid wallflower who's afraid of their own shadow person, because both can be consumed with a me first mentality. It welcomes the pastor who builds a multi-million dollar mega ministry and names it all after himself. And it welcomes the small church pastor who looks with jealousy and envy and suspicion at every church or ministry that's larger than his. See, pride is spelled with an I in the middle. And pride's path to greatness put an I in the center. With Romans 2 called self-seeking, in other words, pride's path to greatness bends everything on that person so that in their own eyes and mind, they are the center focus of everything they care about. See, from this angle, pride's path to greatness isn't limited to great things. It's just pressing ourselves forward. Number one, jockeying for the number one position. The person who lives for himself or herself is pursuing greatness as defined by pride. Leave me alone and let me do what I want to do, when I want to do it, and how I want to do it. You can't be great because that's pride getting in your way. This path towards greatness leaves a trail of damage. Marriages are sabotaged by one or both spouses living selfishly. Relationships between parents and children are often damaged when a parent or child or both are consumed by their own perspective and desires. Churches can be torn apart by those who have self-promoting agendas, not only by the lay people, but also by the pastors who are driven by self-promoting agendas. See, to the extent that we live selfish lives, no matter how small or unaccomplished those lives may be, to the extent that we are pursuing our own greatness on the path of pride, and like the disciples, I think most of us can say this. This isn't just a one-time event. This is an ongoing sin issue in my life. I know that the path of pride runs through my heart sometimes, which is sinfully bent in on itself. Sometimes I lobby for my own greatness, and so do you. It's a human condition because of pride. Our compass towards greatness points in exactly the wrong direction. But we can take heart that Jesus doesn't reject us just like he didn't reject his disciples because of our pride. He didn't cast them away. But he did patiently correct them in order to turn them into repentance. And as we consider Christ's path to greatness, may the Holy Spirit do that in our hearts on this morning as well. But now we figured out how pride is messing us up. How does Christ turn us around? Jesus calls his disciples together in verse 35. and begins to teach them what true greatness really is. He begins by flipping the order of greatness around. Look with me into that verse again. He says, if anyone would be first. Jesus begins with this because that's where the disciples were. They reduced greatness to rank and who will be first. And Jesus knows exactly where to hit you at when you get a little bit above yourself. You know sometimes how our parents used to, when we talked out of turn and gotten above ourselves, talked beyond our measures, and something, but they don't do this now. They hit you in your throat. They smack in your face. They take the broom. You know, I think it was child abuse back then, but look where we are now. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. But he must, and he says it like this, he must be last and serve all. So Jesus flips the order. The way to the front of the line is to choose the back of the line. Pride's path to greatness said you arrive when you are first in line. You're a great one, others serve you. But Christ's path to greatness said you've arrived when you serve others. He says in the same thing in chapter 10 when he contrasts how the Gentiles use their authority to lord it over others, and the authority just means that you have more and more power to get others to obey the me first cravings in your hearts. I'm always amazed at how cruel dictators can live in lavish luxury on the backs of their people living in object poverty. How can a human being think it's more important for them to have 500 pairs of shoes than a starving man to be begging for bread to feed his family? How can they live in a sprawling palaces while with millions live in broken down huts? The answer is the path of pride says that the dictator is great, which just means that their hearts cry me first, and they're ratified by their positions, their politics, and their military might. We have seen this on display for 4 years. We have seen how pride can take down a country for 4 years. We have seen how people want to bend the rules just because it don't fit them. And we've seen a man try to claim an election was rigged when the rigged election is when Russia 4 years ago turned over the vote to put him in power. But Jesus says greatness is becoming a servant.
Yeah.
And the more you serve, the greater you become. To illustrate this, Jesus used 2 living examples. In this same chapter, in these same verses, 36 and 37, Jesus brings a child into the midst of the disciples. Then he takes the child in his arms. We see in the gospel that Jesus loves children, and children love Jesus. And he says, whoever receives one such child in my name receives me. And whoever receives me, not only they receive me, they receive the one who sent me. See, it's a little hard for us to understand Jesus' meaning in this because kids actually have pretty high status in our culture today. But in the day of Jesus, children had little to no status. They had no greatness of their own and none to bestow. See, pride's path to greatness says it's not what you know, but who you know, and it's a pretty common thing to use people to advance one's own reputation. But Jesus is saying that his path to greatness is caring for those who have nothing to give back. It's not limited to children. It can apply to the poor, the outcast, and the socially unloved. When we open our arms and hearts to those that have nothing to give us and no way to advance our cause, we are opening our arms and our hearts to Christ himself. And when we do that, we are opening our arms and our hearts to God, our Father. And if we pause, we can understand why this is the right and appropriate time. To God, no one is great. No one is impressive. And none of us have anything to give to God or any way to get it or purchase his acceptance or affections. We can only relate to God as poor and needy sinners who need his help. And when we come to him in that position, he loves to bestow his grace upon us. If we look at Isaiah 66, the 66th chapter, the second verse, he said, "But this is the one whom I will look, he who is humble and contrite in spirit and trembles at my word." See, and that brings us to Jesus. The second example I want us to turn to is chapter 10, 45. Remember, we're talking about true greatness. Jesus is great beyond our imagination. Jesus is God, but he veiled the glory of his greatness by putting on human flesh and taking the form of a servant. He did not come here to be served. He came here to serve. In the upper room, as the 12 disciples prepared for what we know now as the Last Supper, Jesus took off his robe and wrapped himself in a towel and began to wash the disciples' feet, because that was the lowliest servant's job. So as the men and women came from their travels, before they could eat dinner, the servant had to wash the crusty, nasty, filthy. They ain't had no Nikes, they ain't had no Jordans, they ain't had no Balenciagos, they didn't have no Christian Louis Vuittons. All they had was some dusty sandals. And Jesus got on his hands and knees and washed his feet, their feet. See, he came to serve. And that service reached its pinnacle of greatness when Jesus reached the depth of his humiliation. As he hung on the cross, mocked and scorned, and humiliated and suffering, his greatness was on full display.
Yeah.
The greatness of his love, the greatness of his sacrifice,
yeah,
the greatness of his humanity, the greatness of his obedience to his Father. I know we sing a song that says, "Think about his love, think about his goodness, think about his grace that brought us through as high as the heaven above." So great is the measure,
yeah,
of our Father's love.
Yeah.
Great is the measure of our Father's love. See, the gospel isn't about our greatness. It's not about a motivational speech to stir us up to do great things. The gospel begins and it ends with the greatness of Jesus Christ, not ours. We have a great Savior of living sacrifice, he was guilty of living a selfless life, and but folk that lived a selfish life killed him. Every one of us, but Jesus didn't reject them. He died for them, and he died for us so that anyone who trusts in Jesus would be washed clean of our selfish, self-promoting sin. See, the ground is level at the cross, and we all come empty and needy and poor and very, very ungrateful. And Jesus promised to forgive us of that sin. So if you are convinced this morning that the sin of selfishness and convicted of the sin of selfishness and self-seeking, the issue isn't primarily what you do or don't do. The problem is your heart. The path of pride runs through your heart. As Dr. Bobby Eugene Holmes used to often say, it's a inside job. And anytime it's an inside job, you need to have open heart surgery. If you want to be great, you got to go to the great physician. If you want to be who God called you to be, you got to have open heart surgery. You got to get a heart transplant. You said, "Let there be the mind be in me that's also in Christ Jesus." But when your heart is right, your mind becomes right. When your heart and your mind mind becomes right, your soul becomes right. And then you can get the greatness, because that means you're not afraid to serve. There are too many people that stand behind too many pulpits that want to be served and ain't willing to get down and dirty in the house that you preach in. There's too many preachers that stand behind a pulpit and all they want to do is have somebody running after them. It's my drink at 45 degrees Fahrenheit. I need my tea at 145 degrees. I cannot go out and preach if these things are, they got a rather like they are hip hop artists. Their concerns are long. Their concerns are detailed. But if you're going to be great in the eyes of God, you have to do what Jesus did. And sometimes that means get on your hands and your knees. And it ain't the gravel, it ain't the bag, but it's to serve the ones that you were sent to serve. Preachers, you ain't the server. You ain't the server. You're not the one that needs to be served. You are the servant. And who do you serve? The people that God sent you to love, sent you to preach to, and sent you to do. See, too many times we think the preacher, we see folk on TV and think they all this and all that. But let the truth be told, they got more stuff in their bag, and they like in the grocery store. They just putting stuff in their car. They got so much mess, so much, and oh, I want to be part of that church. Look at that church. That church pretty. That church big. They got a lot of folk over there. Man, look. Puff Daddy and them told you right. More money.
More problems.
More problems. The more people in your church, and we want you to come in here, but the most stuff you got to deal with. The reason why after a church get a certain size, they don't want the preacher working in the regular field, because they understand this one thing. The more people that come in, the more problems come in with them. And if the church was perfect before you got there, when you came in, you brought your problems with you. So here it is now. We seeing what Jesus has done. We understand what Jesus has done. And we figuring out how to be great. So put your pride aside and pick up the cross. And the words in the song said, Jesus, should Jesus bear the cross alone? But there is a cross for you and a cross for me. Too many times we don't want to have the humiliation of the cross. But it's the humiliation of the cross that allows you to know that you just filthy, you just dirty, and the only reason you are where you are is because of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. And amen. Let us, as we look at this thing, as we reflect, let us please understand this. Every person that belongs to every church, every believer is messed up. And the only way we are righteous, to God is through the lens of Jesus Christ. Through the lens of Jesus Christ. So on today, we ask you, if you want to be saved, we offer Christ to you today. We offer Christ to you today if you want to be saved. Because salvation is more important than church membership. Salvation is more important. To be saved is more important than church membership or which church you belong to. You got to be saved. So first, we offer the gift of salvation through Jesus Christ. I can't save you. No preacher in here can save you. No deacon can save you. No church disciple can save you. The only person, the only thing that can save you is Jesus. But after you've been saved and you need a church home, we offer the Fairfield Baptist Church to you. A place that's going to love you, a place that's going to nurture you, and a place that's going to support you and put your gifts to you. Use. So if you're here or you're listening and you're ready to be a disciple, we don't have members, the disciples of this ministry, we offer discipleship to you. And thirdly, you want to rededicate your life back to Christ. We don't rededicate lives back to the church. You rededicate it back to Christ. Because when the church is gone, just you and Jesus, and are you going to be dedicated to Christ? Is there one? Is there one? Amen. Amen. Well, how can you reach us? You can reach us on Facebook. You can reach us on YouTube. You can reach us on our email, fbc1500@gmail.com. FFBC1500@gmail.com. Just send us an email. Send us an inbox. Put it on the wall. And we'll make sure we reach out to you as we can. We'll make sure we reach out to you. Amen. As we get ready to depart from this place, we ask you to continue to reach out to one another, support one another. In any way you feel that you can do it safely. We ain't having no parties, we ain't getting together like that. But any way you can feel that you can connect, save you. That's why we got the telephone, the Instagrams, the Twitter, the text messages. Reach out to people and keep connected. Like the devil tried to disjoint us, disconnect us, and pull us far away. This is where we need to stay closer to one another. Amen. Man, as we depart from this place, but never from your presence, in the name of Jesus, we pray. We thank you, God, for allowing us to come and worship and allow us to come and preach and allow us to come and receive a word. We ask you to be with us, hold us, and keep us until we meet again. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. And amen.